Hello everyone, my name is Ishika Singh and I'm your host for today, and I welcome you all to another episode of Saturday Suspense. So before we begin, I would like to introduce you all to our guest for today. She's the soul who has beautifully knitted these stories between India and Bhutan. Apart from this, she's also the director of Everest PR, a company that offers a 360-degree approach to PR, media and communication solutions. So this ambitiously amazing person I'm talking about is none other than Vidhi Bubna Ma'am. A very warm welcome, ma'am. So how have you been doing?
Thank you so much for inviting me to your show. I've been doing good. What about you?
I'm also doing good, ma'am. So without further ado, we'll begin with the questionnaire. Is that fine by you, ma'am?
Yes.
Okay. So my first question to you would be, could you tell us more about your company, Everest PR, and its works?
So Everest PR was started by me in the year 2019, and it's actually an initiative where we aim to increase the media presence of clients that we work with. So we work with clients across pharmaceutical, real estate, sports, and a lot of other media channels. And the main aim of our company is, you know, to help our clients out with digital marketing, public relations, reputation management, crisis communication, and the like.
Ma'am, that was really insightful. So again, moving to the next question, like, as you are the Indo-Bhutan ambassador, could you throw some light on the relation of India and Bhutan that the general public is unaware of?
So the India-Bhutan relationship looks very easy and outgoing to the normal audience when you look at it or read about it in the newspapers. But that's because the image that we see of the relationship is very, very censored. So though in the past, ever since India and Bhutan's independence, we've shared a very good relationship, and the relationship is dependent on mutual benefits which both the countries receive. Even then, right now, at the present moment, we are facing kind of a rift from Bhutan, and that's because a lot of Bhutanese nationals, they have a choice. They can either choose between Japan or between ties with India. And right now, they feel like India is imposing on Bhutan's independence and also imposing a lot of other feelings which Bhutanese nationals have. So a lot of Bhutanese people are now choosing Japan over India, and the Embassy of India is actively working to strengthen ties between India and Bhutan, just like they always do.
Oh, ma'am, that was like really something which I didn't know, because this is not a topic of discussion for normal people like us. Like, on the borders, it might be an issue, but over here, we like rarely come to know about such kind of things. And also, we came to know that you wanted to play a role in India-China dialogues. So what's your stand on this? The relations are like evidently sour. So like what, and we are somehow unable to curb the dependency that we have on them. So what's your take on this?
So I just believe that India-China relations are currently India and China have never been friends, to be very honest, because they are the two leading most populous countries in Asia, and China is always going to be a competitor, and India is always going to be China's competitor, and that's just the reality. Like, even if you see the policy which China came up with recently, which is the three children policy, that all parents are now allowed to have three children in China. It's a clear policy which is made to combat India's growing population. China wants to ensure that it's the most populous country in Asia, and India also wants to keep that position and, you know, work towards like building on that. So I just think that China and India, even if there's a lot of space for mutual cooperation, all our other neighbors are forced to pick between either working with China or working with India. And often, because we have a lot of other people in the situation as well, a lot of other neighboring countries, India and China cannot really be friends.
Yeah, that really is the issue, because like even if being friends, like that situation does not resolve. There are always like some kinds of disputes that are going on in the borders like that. So I believe, yeah, that's true. And my next question to you would be that we have a series of questions regarding the media for you now. So most of the people, even now, don't usually follow the online media outlets which show the ground reality, unlike the publicized TV news channels. So what are your views on bringing about a change and awareness among the public in this regard?
I just think that, you know, especially in a country like India, whenever we speak, we need to keep in mind the population that we're looking at, first of all. In America, the situation is very different because people often read New York Times or the Washington Post because they know that they will get an unbiased opinion from there and that they are very, very aware of that. In the same way, if you see Russia, Russia has its public newspaper, which is called Sputnik. And people across Russia read Sputnik, but they are not aware that it's very biased. And they're actually being fed propaganda. In the same way, when Indians are actually watching the news, they watch Republic, but they are not aware that Republic is a lot of propaganda and it's pro-BJP material only. So I just think that it's important for us to create an awareness so that we know what kind of content we are taking in. We know if it's propaganda, if it's the harsh ground reality.
Yeah, we really deserve an unbiased news when like, it's such a diverse country, but as of now, it's not possible. So it needs to change. I agree with you. And the next question to you would be, so when we're talking about media, so you, my next question to you would be that a lot of outrage is being shown on social media pages these days. So what are your views on this? Like, how can we create a better space for humanity through social media platforms?
I think that social media, again, is very, very selective. Like we end up following the pages that we believe in, or we end up following people whose mindset is similar to ours. So it's more like an echo chamber where whatever we believe in is being thrown back at us at the same time. So suppose you're already anti-BJP, you're definitely not going to follow Republic social media. And if you're a liberal, you're more likely to follow Vice social media or Washington Post or New Yorker. So your source of information is already biased by the accounts which you follow on social media. And you can already see that, you know, social media is not removing any bias, it's just increasing it. Like recently in the movie, The Social Dilemma, they had shown that Facebook's actually responsible for creating a civil war in Myanmar. So if you go and think about it, I don't think social media is taking away any problems of outrage or extremism. Social media is in fact amplifying it. Like even if you see ISIS or read more about the way ISIS operates, you will realize that ISIS has used a lot of social media channels in the past to recruit people, like Telegram, WhatsApp groups. ISIS has used all of these social media tools.
So what is the way that we can curb this thing? Like stopping this thing is like boycotting social media the solution, or we can't even trust the news channels. So where will we go? Like, which source to trust?
Accurate news?
Yeah.
You trust any free journals which does not believe in advertisements. And there are a lot of these platforms on the internet. You can read Bloomberg, you can read New York Times, and you can even check out some economic newspapers or publications like CNBC. So I just think these are going to be more unbiased and present to you a real image rather than reading any national or anything like Times of India. Basically, don't read Times of India.
Okay, ma'am, that was a very clear-cut response. And the next question is, like media outlets with a particular agenda or focusing on coverages in depth or the one focusing on overall issues, which one, according to you, is sounder and more demanded by the audience? And which one does your focus lie on?
What the audience demands is generally not what is best for the audience. Like generally the things we want are not good for us, is what I believe. So even if you see the audience now with this new app called InShorts, we just want to know the headline in short. We want to know whatever's happening in the easiest possible terms, and we are not looking at an in-depth analysis. A lot of people, when they go to the newspaper today, they just read the headlines. They don't even read what's written down. So I think the way we see, as an audience, see news is supposed to change. And we should read more in-depth articles. It's better to know about one thing in detail rather than knowing about 10 things just superficially.
So I believe that is a gradual process. It will take time because like everybody in today's world is biased towards like the government or the opposition. So it is a gradual process. So the next question would be, is there anything still to be developed in media outlets? Because there has been a huge change in the industry since the 90s. Do you feel the changes are good or bad?
I think that right now all the media outlets are currently focusing on advertising rather than actually giving out news. So whatever brings them the most advertising revenues, whatever gives them the most number of clicks on their websites is going to be prioritized. And I don't think that's good for us.
Yes, exactly. I do agree with this point of yours. And this brings us to the end of the questions related to media. And the next questions will be related to your experience in your profession. So of your experience and connections, what are some startup ideas that you've come across that could grow the most and be advantageous and inspiring for others in the coming future?
So I think some startups which would be good in the near future are basically anything related to the digital space. Because now if you see, COVID came and disrupted everything since the last 1.5 years. And if you go to see, then I think that any startup which is dealing in the space of digital marketing or digital selling, e-commerce is likely to boom.
Okay, ma'am. We'll look forward to see those ideas growing. And the next question is, as a working woman, what are your views on women empowerment in our country?
So I think that women empowerment is something that, you know, we speak about in the cities, but a lot of people in rural areas are not really taking it very seriously and are not getting affected by it. Even if you see the Me Too movement, Me Too was essentially a digital movement and people were writing Me Too on their Facebook and Instagram timelines. But I think that left a lot of rural India out, which does not use digital platforms. So even if Me Too was empowering, it was just empowering a particular section of society. And I think that things like this need to change. We need to include more people in our women empowerment campaigns. And India also, when we speak of India or Indian women and women empowerment, there are a lot of different groups in India also. Like there are women who are working, there are women who are at home. And both of them deserve equal respect. But if they are doing it by choice, then there are women living in the city, women living in rural India. Both of them have very different lives. And I think both of them deserve to be empowered equally.
So, ma'am, do you have any sort of ideas like we can increase their inclusivity, like in work environment, or if there is a choice, like staying at home is a choice, then it's fine. But inclusivity, that empowering thing, how can we promote it? Like, are there some ideas of yours?
I think speaking up is one of the best ways in which you can not only empower yourself, but also empower people around you. Like a lot of women, maybe in the workspace, they face harassment, or at home, they are disrespected by their families, or they have to go through some kind of, struggle with their families to explain to them where they're coming from. So I just think that speaking up is the most powerful thing you can do for yourself and for people around you and for women who are growing up around you, who are like watching you. And a lot of it has to do with self-empowerment. When you talk to women who are empowered themselves, you also feel empowered. So you need to surround yourselves with women who think alike, who are not afraid of speaking up. Because the women you surround yourself with is going to be what you as a woman turn into at some point. And I also think self-education is very important. Like every woman should read some books about women empowerment so that she's aware of how they've affected her. Like there's this book called Invisible Women, which I recommend to all women I meet. And I also recommend this book, which is called What We Talk About When We Talk About Rape. It's written by Sohaila Abdullahi. And she talks about rape culture in India and basically across the world. And also highlights how women empowerment is related to rape.
So, ma'am, that was really a beautiful answer. And it was really insightful. People do need to speak up. So, and again, so the next question is, your journey till now is like that might not have been easy for sure. So what are some of the hurdles that you have faced and how did you overcome them?
So I think one of the biggest hurdles, speaking of women empowerment only, that I've faced is women trying to pull other women back because they couldn't achieve what they see the women of today achieving because they have their own insecurities. Some women cannot see other women doing very well. So I think those women need to be called out in the workspace or, you know, in other spaces as well. Because if women don't empower each other, we cannot expect men to stand up for us either, you know. Like, we just need to set up that standard of solidarity And I think that women fail to do that in the workspace sometimes. So that's what's held me back at a point. And I just feel like I've learned to overcome that.
That was really good. And also, there's one question, like, coming up with this idea of Everest PR, like, there must have been some sort of a motivation, some sort of an inspiration that I need to do this thing, because there are a lot of things that we want to do, but choosing this field, how come that decision came to, like?
So I think that a lot of my choice of starting Everest PR actually has to do with the state of media today. I feel like media is not giving enough attention to the small brands or to issues which actually need to be focused on. So by joining the field of PR, I feel like I'm shaping the narrative of what is being said in the media and what people are actually thinking about. And that's a very powerful tool. As soon as you can control what other people think about, I think you have a certain power over the way public perception is shaped. And in the long run, that not only benefits the brands you're working with or your clients, but you can also change the world in a very small way by choosing who you work with, whose voice you choose to amplify, whose voice can be heard.
Ma'am, I must say that that was a really, really to the point reason to start something. Like, it was not vague or something like that. It had strong grounds. And my next question to you would be, now we are done with profession and experiences, and the next segment is related to your personal life. So that would be really fun. The first question would be, we got to know that you love trekking and have been often visiting the Himalayas, which keep you inspired and provide to you new ideas. So would you like to tell us more about it? And it seems that Everest has been aptly named for your company.
So I actually developed a love for trekking at the age of 17. And, you know, having always grown up in the city, I just wanted to see what living in the mountains is like. And I decided to go to the Himalayas for a week and live there. And basically, we stayed there in a tent and, you know, made our own food, got water from a river nearby, and then boiled it so that there was no bacteria. So just this experience made me understand what the word privilege is all about, you know. Like, we often take the water running in our homes for granted, and we never see it as a luxury. But living in the mountains just changed my perspective about a lot of things. And I knew that somewhere deep down, it's a better way of living. Maybe a better alternative to the rat race or living in the city. And, you know, to constantly fight for attention, that feeling of competition. And when you go to the Himalayas, you realize that it's just about you. It's your story. It's about your life. It's about you being close to nature and doing what makes you happy.
I guess that the solace you got there, like, really changed you as a person in and out. So talking about college life, so it is a very memorable part of one's life. So when you went to study liberal arts in Ashoka University, how was life there? Please share your experiences.
I think Ashoka University is one of the best places in India where any student, even if you're interested in engineering or maybe anything, it's one of the best places where you can be. And that's because life is not just about, say, science, chemistry, physics, math, or, you know, studying the big things. It's also about learning the small things, like maybe picking up a book of literature and learning how to enjoy it completely, or learning more about the relations of India, China, India, Bhutan. You don't know how these little things will help you in the long run, but they really do. And a liberal education helps you to shape yourself as a person, as an individual. It helps you to develop your own individuality. Whereas I feel like engineering as a field, or maybe, you know, pure MBA or anything which involves a lot of focus, instead of shaping you as a complete individual all around, an individual who's very aware about things, maybe it just teaches you that you're one in 300 students, that you need to fight to be the best. You need to compete for the best job. But when I was at Ashoka, it was never about competing. It was always about shaping yourself as an individual. And that's what I really appreciate about the university.
That was a really beautiful answer. And again, with this, we come to the next question. Like, when we went through your Instagram post, so there was a clear craving for returning back to the Himalayas, to the close vicinity of nature. What keeps you bound to nature?
I think it's just the feeling of being genuine and feeling like I'm an individual, which actually takes me back to the Himalayas. And also the simplicity of the people there. Like whenever I go to the mountains, I interact with the locals who are living there. And a lot of these locals have never even left the mountains. They are just living there ever since they were born and they don't want to leave. They know that city life, they're probably going to earn more money, have better opportunities. But that's not what they're seeking in life. So we read all these books, you know, we read like Jay Shetty's books and then Robin Sharma. And it's all about finding inner peace. But how often do we actually go on that journey ourselves to find it? It's very easy to sit at home and read a book and say, hey, I want to be someone as peaceful as that. But how often do we actually go out and do something which is going to make us more peaceful? Okay. It's about the act. So it's more about not talking about peace and feeling peaceful, I think.
That is really true because nobody in today's world, like, there's nobody who wants to find peace. Like, everybody wants to stride, keep
talk
striding,
about.
Like, move on in their head. Yeah. So that is the thing. It is for sure a problem. So this year and the year that has gone by, it has not been easy for anyone. So how are you keeping yourself motivated during these tough times?
I think motivation is something that comes from within. And you need to keep yourself motivated by knowing what your goals are. And to be honest, it's very easy to lose sight of that. It's very easy to feel like, you know, today I'm just going to lie down in bed and not get up and maybe just watch my favorite Netflix film. But the question you need to keep asking yourself is, how is this going to help me in the next 10 years? If you think it's going to help you, you might as well do it. You might as well watch that Netflix film. If your goal in life is to be a movie reviewer, I'm sure watching Netflix is going to help you. But if your goal in life is to be, you know, a professor, to be like someone who's shaping international relations, you need to get up and you need to work towards it every single day. And that work is going to take you very far. Like every small step is going to take you very, very far. So I think it's about that. It's about waking up and working on your goals.
Yes, ma'am. I do believe that that for sure is true. But there were people like who suffered a lot. Like sitting at home, we are at much comfort, like in comparison to others, to small people like who have like no sources or something like that. So have you thought on that aspect? Like if anybody like that who has like suffered a lot, not in terms of money, but in terms of like personal loss, a lot of people lost family members. And if
yes.
people like that are watching our show, so what is one advice that you would like to give to them?
I would just like to say that if you need to heal, that's the most important part of you. Just like I go to the Himalayas to find peace, I think everyone needs their healing time. And that's the most important thing you can do for yourself. Your career, even if it sticks by you, it's not going to matter till your mental health is fine. And I think that the most important thing you can do for yourself is just take care of your mental health.
That is a good answer, and I hope everybody who watches this gets to learn something. So it was great fun interacting with you, and we hope you had an amazing time too. So at last, what is one piece of advice that you have for the students of IIT ISM?
I think for any student, my main advice would be just be out there, find yourself. Don't be out there at university with the agenda of having the best job, or, you know, to be more competitive than your friends or to score the best marks. Even if you fail in one semester because you took a trip and you decided to, you know, just go out somewhere with a bunch of your friends for like a life-changing experience, I think that's more valuable than getting an A grade in your class. So I think make stupid mistakes because they are going to be teaching you the most in your life. Until you make mistakes, your mistakes shape you who you are rather than those A's in your grade.
Ma'am, this was like a huge learning experience for me because we have also entered this vicious circle of competition. Like every day we are thinking about this person is doing this, I need to get this done. So it's about thinking about ourselves, what we want in life. But yes, competition hits you at sometimes, like, but we should change. Yeah, I believe it was really fun talking to you. It was a very big learning experience.
It was really nice talking to you as well. Thank you, Ashika. Thanks for all your questions. They made me think a lot more about, you know, whatever I'm doing in my life and the way I should see things now. So, yeah, thank you so much for your questions.
Thank you, ma'am.